So in checked out source code, you can find the Unix, Win32, macOS, and iOS. Also, cross is a cross-platform, so is a subdirectory for cross-platform code. So this code used by all the platforms. And usual layout for platform code is to have the VM subdirectory and then plugins subdirectory, and for each plugin with the name of plugin you have the corresponding subdirectory. So when you go here you have some custom files for specific plugin for given platform. And same for cross, you have same plugins and VM subdirectory. So here you have the cross platform sources for virtual machine, which common for all platforms. And here you can find the cross platform source files for separate plugins if they need it. Okay, what we can do is to create a subdirectory here, so it could be in same parent directory as platforms. So and put the image which you with VM Maker here. So like that you have the unpacked source tree, and then in subdirectory you have the image you built with VM Maker. It's clear?
Create this
directory VM Maker. Yes. You can actually use image from anywhere, but then you have to change to put the custom directories in the build. So out of the box, without custom parameters, it works from a subdirectory. You can use any subdirectory name. Just by default, it made so that the scripts which residing in image will use the parent directory. Will look for platform subdirectory in parent directory, and it will also use the parent directory for placing the subdirectories there, which will contain generated code. Yeah, it's just so if it won't bark at you that it don't contains cannot find source files. Ah. Okay, run the image. The image you where you loaded the VM maker and copy it to the directory. Additionally, you should do this to load CMake VM Maker package, or you can do it manually if you don't like to type. You can just use Monticello browser, go to VM Maker repository and load the CMake VM Maker package. Use mine because I don't check what Esteban did there, so maybe it could break something. Yeah, sure. So everyone installed the CMake VM Maker package? Okay.
It's already in the demo image or something?
Yes, it's already in demo image. If you have demo image, yes, there is already. Okay. Now for Mac OS. For those who use Max, you can either use the first line or second line, depending what virtual machine you want to build. So the first one is JIT cog, and second one is stack interpreter. So it's an interpreter without JIT included. You can use either one and second. So I proceed with stack interpreter macOS config and just do it. And it will start generating the virtual machine source code. Yes, it will appear in parent directory, build subdirectory. You can remove that directory before generating any source.
What's the name of your class in Windows?
Huh?
Windows config, what's the name of that class?
In Windows, there is no config yet. Okay, so it's done generating. And we can check what it does. So here's a build directory, and the main file which is generated is the CMake list which contains come on. So this is generated configuration for building virtual machine. And in each subdirectory there's also CMake lists which has a configuration for building corresponding plugin. So what we do now is just go to the for Linux you use different configuration. Yes. For building on Linux you use let me check. No, it's same package. There is there only different different. So you use cog either cog Unix config. Or stack interpreter Unix config. So you issue the same command. Either cog Unix config generate with sources or stack interpreter config generate with sources. So good. So far so good. Now we go to the build directory. And first which we'll invoke is cmake dot which will generate the make files for compilation of virtual machine. And then we just do make. And it starts building the virtual machine. Huh? So you do cd build, cmake dot, and then make. First you type cmake dot, cmake space dot, or period. And then make. Works?
Linux, the dev package for OpenGL is
Yes, you have to install the
OpenGL dev.
Yes. Let me check. Yeah, on Linux it's always like that. You have to solve all the dependencies, like install the development versions of libraries for OpenGL. Let me check. There's a list of them. So if you can see, there is libgl mesodev, libglue mesodev, you can check the file which located in Unix build, how to build, there is a list of So who should they make comment?
I had to rename, so there was a cock icon missing.
Yes.
But you can just copy another icon.
It seems that you took a different repository.
Yes.
Yes. You take it. Yeah.
Then there is a cog app there.
So you built it already?
Mm-hmm.
So run it.
let me run it first. You feel empowered like that?
So, and I have the since I used the I use the stack VM configuration. I have the stack VM.ipp in as built artifact, so I can run it. Yes?
Where is it saved?
In build. There is a dot app.
I don't remember.
How do we find out the version?
Hmm?
How do we find out the version from the image?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure. Ah, yes, you can.
VM parameter.
VM parameter. I think there is VM version or something like that. Oh yes. Version label. No, wrong.
No, it's get system attribute 1008. That's the magic invocation.
There is no gate system. Ah, yeah. So this is a VM which I built just a couple minutes ago. Yes, macOS built on March 7, 1545. 1008. Yes. No, it's new. Just 1006. Yes.
There's still problems with generating the code in the Windows. So how?
On Windows, sorry, I don't. We don't have yet the automated build for Windows.
So
you can follow the. You can go to the Win build view, and follow instructions in how to build file. Yeah, this might be difficult.
One week 08 is on the set if you built the copy.
What do you say?
1008.
I built the stack VM. And I think it actually. Yes, most probably yes. There is not big difference from VM side. Yes.
Is there a way to compile with the debug mode?
Yes.
The CMake
compiler? Yes. You just go to the. Okay, I will close this image because it's. So you can check the. The hierarchy, there is already classes which. So you can see that there is a, for instance, for Unix. Okay, I will open the hierarchy for all the classes. So you see, for Unix you have the stack interpreter Unix config, and also you have the stack interpreter debug Unix config. So you can use this configuration for configuring build with debug information, and same for stack for macOS. For macOS I'm not included this, but it's easy to add additional class and include
the target.
What exactly is this thing doing? What exactly is it doing?
This classes? Yeah, this classes contain the information necessary for generating the CMake files, which you then to produce make files, which then build VM. The idea of this is to capture all the information of all dependencies and all the flags and configuration you need to build the VM for different target and different for specific target and specific configuration. Once you captured everything and once you can reproduce this and build the VM out of concrete configuration, then you can distribute it and let other people do the same. I also have a Linux box, and I can also build the VM here. Yeah, my virtual Linux box don't have internet connection for some other reason. Yes. It usually works, but of course not during the demonstration. Yeah, who built the virtual machine? Oh, quite a good number. More than 50%, yes? Good. So, we can go and create our first plugin. Good? So open the system browser. You should know how to use it. Yes.
For those using Linux, there should also be in the list free GLUT. It's from OpenGL because the other packages don't have the link level.
It's this one because the other packages that you mentioned here don't have the linked libraries, actually, at least for Ubuntu.
Mm. it's you know, depending on Linux flavor,
yes,
you have different libraries. So one of the tasks of you as developers is to check the configuration and check and modify for your platform to make sure that it works, or at least include the in comment, include the, all the libraries you need to load for concrete configuration for concrete Unix platform. So you can put into cunix-config the comment here and then submit to vmmake, or just pass me the patch and I will submit it. We slowly gathering all the knowledge about building virtual machine on different platforms, and it takes a while. But our goal is to make sure that configuration works out of the box. So you just issuing as simple as configuration name, generate resources, and you're done.
Is there a way to set C flags that are to be used for each one?
Yes, you just create an own subclass of configuration and supply an own C flags. So I can show you, for instance, the stack interpreter debug Unix config. I will write the compiler class, and you can see it using common compiler flags and then debug, which is this string. Yes? So it checks the for Linux config. I meant the build artifact should reside in results subdirectory in build directory. So there should be a virtual machine executable and few external modules. So check that. Because I put the flag to produce all warnings. Because
why there are so many warnings in the code?
In the code, because obviously the code generator produced not very good, not very standard code, or not. For instance, it produces the extra temporaries which then the compiler detects that they are not used. So it just compiler just warns that you have the temporaries which not used.
Because all warnings are not activated. There's no warning all or something like
that. They are activated. You can build using make verbose equal one. And you can see all the flags which passed to compiler. So, yeah.
Igor, can I ask something?
Yes.
Since CMake is something like AutoTools, AutoConf, etc., shouldn't complain if there are missing headers or libraries like AutoTools does?
Who complains?
Usually when you have a compilation chain with AutoTools,
yes,
during configuration, which is the equivalent of CMake, you get like you are missing this.
Yeah, we have to fix that in configuration. So we have to include all the knowledge, because right now it's just things which works, you know. So we gradually we will get everything done in these files. But the point is to move to move the source code and to be manage this code in a Smalltalk. So I moved. So for instance, Ian produced the CMA configuration for all the virtual machine, and it's residing in separate directory, and there is a files, and they are manually crafted. But the problem with this that you have only one virtual machine configuration, and with this you can just subclass and modify something which works for you, and you can check, and then you have reproducible results which you can share with others. That's the point of moving the configuration generation from files to Smalltalk. So you have all the configuration stored in one package, so you can share it with other people. Okay, I will give you example to create own plugin. Oh, maybe let's talk first about our automated build system. So this is an outline how we seen it, how automated build system works. So as input, the build system takes the URL to base image and the git gitorio snapshot which located on gitorio. So once user and actually URL is also residing in git repository. So once you do the commit to git repository with some modified version, it triggers the build on Hudson server or Jenkins, whatever. So it downloads the core image which will be used as base for loading the VMmaker, and it using the VMmaker configuration and tries to load VMmaker, produce the image which contains the VMmaker. Why we need that? We want to verify that for our bleeding edge image, we can load the latest, in our latest and greatest image, we can always load the VMmaker package. Because we always, during these years, we always have the same problem. Users can't just make it work. They cannot download and install VMmaker into their image. So with this step, we can verify that whatever we do with our bleeding edge technology, we can verify that we can successfully load the VMmaker, so we can make sure that it works. So the next step, what it does is actually, it's automatically doing what we just did manually. It generates the source code and generates the CMA config files, and then just issuing the make command. So as a result, you got the pre-built virtual machine on Hudson server, which you can download and check. And then also, of course, once build succeeds, additionally, we will create a configuration to run tests on newly built virtual machine, so we can track if there are some breakage during some introduction of new features. And also in parallel to tests, we can also run the suite of benchmarks which could show us if new changes influenced on the speed of virtual machine executable, and depending on which benchmark, we can track the history of of execution engine performance. So that's the idea of making the virtual machine to be streamlined, to have continuous integration for building virtual machine. Okay. Yes, and for instance, here is a simple script which I done for building virtual machine. These scripts are residing in CodeGen subdirectory. So I can show you. So here's the CodeGen scripts, and here's the necessary files for building everything automatically. So with little effort, you can actually use these scripts for generating virtual machine on your own machine.
Are also in the Git.
Yes, it's the scripts residing in Git. So you just usually what you can do, you just checking out the sources, go to this directory, and then executing this shell scripts, and it will build the VM from you.
What exactly does it automate?
Everything.
What we did on the image,
you don't need to interact with image anymore. You just load the source code from a Git repository and then executing the shell scripts.
Okay.
And as a result, you have a built virtual machine. Okay. Oh yes, we still have material to learn about primitives. Okay, this is not take a big time. So what is a primitive? Everyone knows what are primitives, or somebody don't knows. Okay. To my understanding, the primitive in Smalltalk is the operation or feature which we cannot do using plain Smalltalk. For example, you cannot access the you cannot create the small integer object without using primitive. This is you can find in your image, you can find this method in object class which describes what is a primitive, so you can read it at home. So there is specific extra rules for generating primitives using VMmaker. So in a method which you want to become a primitive, you put in the special pragma export true, and then it's producing the corresponding function in source code which are exported for your primitive. So for using a primitive you declared in your plugin, you do export true, and usually if you don't touch anything, you can use from language side, you can use the primitive name as method name which you use for generating code, and the module name as is your plugin name. So here's a suppose that you have class my plugin, and in that class you have primitive foo as a method where you put the export pragma and implement the primitive. Then once you build the virtual machine with this plugin, you can use it by using a primitive module pragma and specify the primitive name as a method name and the plugin name as a module name. Simple. Also, if you can see the generated code for primitive, it takes no arguments, and the return value of this function, of primitive function, also ignored by virtual machine which calls it. So the question is how primitives accessing the arguments and how they returning the value. So in this example, we want to use the primitive foo of module my plugin in some class. So here's the implementation of plugin of primitive, how to access the arguments of primitive. So for instance, if you have a primitive which expects one argument, then you can access the argument using the stack value function, and to access receiver you have also use stack value, but with this different index. So all arguments which use for primitive are pushed from left to right order. So the latest argument are accessible via zero index, and then once which pushed before, the access is greater and greater index. So it's a simple stack layout for passing arguments. Also, when you return in the result, you use it's recommend to use a pop then push method. So in our case, since we use one argument and also the receiver on stack, it's always on stack, so we should pop two values from stack and push one. So in result we have a stack pointer decremented by one, and the result will replace the receiver on stack. Also, keep an eye that you should always check that for primitive which takes n arguments, you should pop n plus 1 and push 1. So make sure that your stack is balanced, because in debug version the VM maker do stack balance checks, but in production version it's not doing the stack balancing checks, and you can crash virtual machine. So it also depends where you invoking.
Igor,
yes.
How it works for cascading messaging? If you remove the receiver,
don't use cascade messages with in Slang code.
No, but if you remove the receiver from the stack.
Ah, with cascade, when you do cascade, it pushes the receiver twice. So there, for every message, it push receiver once more, and then pops, and then again push. It duplicates receiver for each cascade sent. So you don't have to worry about it. Also, for checking the number of arguments, you could use the special argument count method. Well, actually in interpreter this is just a variable, and in plugin you have to use the expression interpreter proxy argument count of interpreter proxy primitive method. But I will talk in detail about this later. There is a difference between plugin and plugin code and the interpreter code. for fail in primitive, you use the primitive fail method. So if you do some checking in primitive, or if you consider that you don't want to proceed further, you can just return with primitive fail, and the primitive immediately will leave the the function body. And it's important to note that you should leave the primitive in same stack state as you entered it. So don't do any pops or pushes on stack, because when primitive fails, okay, I will explain it later. So here's a new way to leave the primitive with failure, which introduced in Coq virtual machine. So in additional to signaling that primitive failed, you additionally can pass the error code. So you can later at language side you can analyze the error code and determine exactly what happened in primitive, what leads to error. And here I put additional slide explaining why error code is better. So here you can see the current implementation of basic add method, and you can see that when primitive fails, it enters the starts interpreting the method. And here you see that the code trying to suggest what happened in primitive. It's not it has no direct knowledge what happened. So it's trying to suggest, okay, maybe the index was integer, then maybe primitive was failed because index is not integer, then we erase the error that it's not a number, or erase errors that subscript out of bounds and things like that. So instead of guessing, if we would use the error codes, if we can just match the error code and produce the message which corresponds to these error codes, which give us much more precise error reporting. That's why error codes are much better.
Where do we get the error code?
It's a dormant currently in VMmaker. It's dormant, but it's just for future development. I mean, you could when you've written plugin, just start using the error codes. We will integrate this passing the error code into language side later.
I didn't got it. It is already implemented, the support in NVM.
There is a special method for reporting error. But it's not the error code is not yet passed to language side.
Not yet.
Yes.
Okay.
But for written plugin or for written your primitives, you could use the error codes. Yes, they are not yet exposed to language side, but you
okay.
You if you planning to write your plugin and you need you want at some date to have good error handling, just start using this instead of using old scheme.
Can we signal an exception from the VM side? So instead of giving
no.
a code, you can
exceptions implemented purely on language side. Virtual machine has only few primitives which supports exceptions, but in a way to make them work a little bit faster, to look up the call chain, to look up the next exception handler in on stack, but not for signaling them. For signaling exceptions, for instance, what virtual machine doing for signaling does not understand message, it just sends the does not understand message to object.
But then,
and then add the implementer, the basic implementer of do not understand signal the error.
Can't we signal, send the message signal?
Yes, you can.
Exception class.
But you, the problem is that in primitive you cannot send message. In primitive you just can fail primitive, and then in the method which as you look above, if you fail primitive, you can in error handler in code which you enter when primitive fails, you can signal exception. So actually primitive failed, signal the exception that primitive failed. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think I will lost voice. Yes, and
there is a question there. The approach that Elliot mentioned for the error code was to define a temporary called DC.
Yes.
That does not work?
It's dormant, it not works.
It doesn't work, okay.
Yes, as far as I seen in current virtual machine, it's not there is no connection between between that and the virtual machine code. So, and for those who not realized it yet, that when primitive fails, the interpreter starts just interpreting the method as usual, as its usual method. So, in this example, if given primitive fails, it just starts interpreting and sends the primitive failed message. The primitive fails not just because your code not send the primitive fail, but also if virtual machine cannot find the module with given name and cannot load or initialize it, or if it can load and initialize module but cannot find the primitive with given name, it also fails the primitive. And if primitive not fails, you never get to this code, and it behaves as if you already sent message and already returned to colored context. So that's quite simple. Yes. A bit more. Two slides, guys. So, yeah. There's also two kind of primitives: numbered ones and named ones. The ones most used is named ones, but numbered ones is a primitives which reside in mostly in interpreter, in core, and to refer to implementation for given number, you can use the initialize primitive table method, which contains the correspondence between the primitive number and the primitive implementation, the method which implements the primitive. So if you're wondering what primitive 100 does, you can look up it in the initialize primitive table method. You can check it. Yes?
Method sends that implement the primitives are inlined by the compiler.
I don't understand the question.
If I want, for example, to call 100 times a primitive,
yes,
I will pay the penalty of code for message sent, or it will be inlined.
So the question is that when you send in the message and the virtual machine found that before entering the actual method, it checks the method header, if you remember from previous slides, the header contains the primitive number. So if this number is not zero, it just enters the primitive. And if primitive not fails, it don't creates any context, anything. So that's why you need to balance stack. So primitive behaves as once it returns and returns with success, it behaves as if you already sent the message. So you, so interpreter pushing the arguments on stack, and then it just calls the primitive. Primitive pops arguments from stack, and then it behaves as if you already returned from the message sent.
Yes, but I was asking if the lookup is done, it's time, but it has to.
Yes, it's always has to do lookup because, yes, it's polymorphic. All sends are polymorphic.
Yes, but for example, if I put now I'm writing a primitive, and then it returns. What if I want to sequentially write two primitives? We cannot do that. No. Call one primitive, then the other without explicitly. So write a new primitive from the start.
Only one primitive.
We cannot.
So for one message sent, you can implement only one primitive. So think about it as if you implement the single method in other language than Smalltalk. It's a black box. So what happens inside a primitive from language side is it's a black box. So it behaves as if it sent message and already received the result. Just for single message. Yes, this is just an example of primitive, but I think it's coffee break, yes.